Welcome to WatchGuard's Daily Security Byte. I'm Corey Nachreiner, and today I'm joined by
Marc Laliberte.
And we're here to talk about Blackhat 2018. Today is Wednesday. It's actually the launch of the first briefing day at Blackhat, which is where you hear all the regular presentations. So for the next 3 days, me and Marc are going to be talking about what we like seeing at Blackhat every day. And for at least one day, we'll talk about DEF CON as well.
Yeah.
So why don't I start it off, Marc, just because I was able to catch the keynote, the starting presentation. Mm-hmm. By the way, it's a huge room now at Blackhat. I think they started last year doing it in this big arena, big light show, lots of colors.
A lot of lasers.
Exactly. Big herd of people trying to get out of there when it's over. But this time, besides having the normal Jeff Moss or Dark Tangent intro, the keynote speaker was Parisa Tabritz, who I believe leads Google's zero-day project. So a lot of researchers that find zero days in many different products, really to help save the internet, actually.
Yeah.
So she talked about a lot of things, but basically talked about how it's up to us, the security industry, to solve all the problems, to kind of push security defaults, to help vendors fix their problems. So she started talking a little bit about zero-day projects, disclosure policy. She talked about their strong 90-day disclosure, meaning after 90 days, if you haven't fixed it, they will disclose. And she said they did that purposely to push vendors to start fixing flaws.
Makes sense. It's something that we've advocated for in the past, too.
In fact, it's our security disclosure vulnerability is, or policy as well.
Yep.
You found a few vulnerabilities in webcams, and 90 days is what we do. So that was interesting. But really, the core of her talk was talking about how to kind of find root cause of problems, not just finding a vulnerability and fixing it basically and calling it a day, but trying to go back, find the root cause, and then sometimes do long-term projects to fix the ultimate problem.
Huh.
And I think she was using kind of Google and Chrome's push for HTTPS is kind of a case study in how to handle long-term issues. They knew that pushing the web to HTTPS wouldn't happen overnight. There's a lot of people that you have to deal with when you're trying to get websites to change. So she talked about picking milestones and celebrating small successes and building a coalition. Not just Google could do that change. They had to work with Firefox and other people. So it was an interesting keynote. I don't think my favorite keynote ever, but I really do like Parisa. She's kind of a cool lead to the zero-day organization.
That does sound pretty cool.
Yeah. How about you? What did you see?
One of my favorite talks I went to today was actually Guillaume Valadon. I'm ruining that horribly.
I would massacre that pronunciation.
Yeah. But he walked through his three-year process of reverse engineering a wireless SD card.
Wow.
So, you know, SD cards, memory for cameras, phones, whatever. Some of them have built-in system on a chips and then wireless capabilities. So you can, while they're powered on in a device, you can connect to them wirelessly to, say, transfer your files off of them without having to physically pull it out of your system.
I didn't realize they were full socks. Like, a system on a chip is like when we have a phone, CPU, GPU, the security, it's like an entire computer on one tiny chip.
Yeah, and so this, it had a few other components in it too, but it was really a Toshiba system on a chip, some storage for the actual storage of it, a wireless controller that was external as well. But he walked through, turns out it was using this really strange architecture that he hadn't really seen before. It was called MEP, not MIPS, but MEP.
Oh, wow. I've never heard of MIPS
either. Media Embedded Processor is what that comes from. And I guess it's actually used quite a bit in MP3 players, he said. The PS Vita uses MEP.
Oh, wow.
And so he walked through. He had to build his own disassemblers for this and his own plugins for other tools that he was using.
That takes a lot of work. Yeah. It's not Linux or a normal operating system. There's no tools to actually reverse it.
Yeah. But the end result of it was he was actually able to get remote code execution wirelessly on this chip through a series of vulnerabilities he found in it.
That sounds pretty awesome.
And it was fascinating watching his whole progress from start to finish and how he attacked this card in almost every single angle.
Yeah.
So how about you? Any other talks?
So yeah, the next two talks, I think, kind of follow a theme. I think a theme just like we talked about RSA a lot in our last set of videos, and machine learning is a big theme here. I'm seeing machine learning in a ton of talks. One of the talks I went to is called Deep Neural Networks for Hackers, and it was just talking about the difference between basic machine learning, deep learning, neural networks, and how you could use them to solve various security problems. Mm-hmm. Joshua Sachs was the chief data scientist that gave this particular talk. But they talked about a lot of novel ways. Like, the one cool thing they made is a URL parser. So as you're typing a URL, they used machine learning to kind of find, is this malicious? Does this look like a URL that would have fish eating?
Huh.
For instance, like if you saw a URL that was PayPal hyphen bunch of random characters hyphen com or something like that. So they use neural networks to look at a ton of good URLs, a ton of phishing URLs, a lot of drive-by URLs, and they made a neural network that used a lot of different techniques, like specifically something called a convolutional neural network.
Sorry, say that again?
Convolutional
so neural network.
So rather than like having humans figuring out the features, the neural network actually figured out all the features of what isn't a bad or good URL.
Is this where like Skynet starts up next?
Exactly, the Terminator's going to take over soon. So it was cool. That's just scratching the surface. They actually have applied machine learning to a lot of different security problems. So that was cool.
Nice.
But then another talk I went at was, the base title of it was Don't At Me. But it was two researchers talking about Twitter bots and how they actually use machine learning to kind of figure out what Twitter bots were by having a big set of known normal Twitter users, a bunch of known spam bots, and basically free crypto bots. And they ran that through normal different types of regression, whether it be logistical regression, clustering models, or what's the tree one? The
decision tree?
Yeah, decision tree. And I think that one was actually the one that won. And they were able to actually identify Twitter bots pretty effectively.
Oh, topical.
So long story short, machine learning, AI, they're the new
buzzword bingo.
Exactly.
The free
that
space.
That said, they are using them for real security mechanisms, too.
Those sound interesting.
How about you? Anything else?
We both ended up at
a
really
cool
fun talk to close out our day, at least, where I can't remember his name.
Let's see. I probably have it. Keep going, though.
Yeah. So the researcher in this case just walked through his vulnerability discovery process on several IoT devices for the industrial area.
Yeah.
So they were like serial to Ethernet servers.
Thomas Roth, by the way.
Yes,
I think was
Thomas
his name.
Roth. So ways you could connect industrial devices to a traditional Ethernet network.
Yeah.
And some of them were pretty bad.
Most of them were bad. It was circa 1990s hacking. So these are a bunch of just different devices that, you know, water plants, dams might use. I think one of them was electrical grid.
Yep.
And he'd do just normal IoT hacking from old school. He'd start by looking at firmware. Is it encrypted? Almost never. Before he even bought the device, he could actually find buffer overflows or find cross-site scripting, or at least find, hey, this uses a web server from 2005. I'm buying this device in 2018, but I know this web server has a ton of vulnerabilities.
So literally,
maybe I'll go find it, and then I will. Yeah.
That was one of my favorite bits, was one of the web servers that were on the devices even had a little image in it that says best viewed in Internet Explorer 5.
Five, y'all. And Boa, by the way. Have you heard of the web server Boa before today?
I've heard of it just through my own IoT research.
Yeah.
But, these were... His whole point in this was they were using software like Linux 2.8. So decade-old kernels,
2.4.
Super old kernels, super old software. And these are devices being sold in 2018.
And then Stack Overflow's everywhere. Basic... A lot of these devices don't have some of the memory protections that modern OS
do. I think he said none of them do.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So it was trivial. In fact, one time he wasn't even trying to find a buffer overflow. He just messed up a parameter, so he sent an overly long packet, and pow, it was a Stack Overflow right away.
Yep.
Classic.
Very, very fun talk, at least if you're on our side of liking to see these interesting
hopefully
hacks.
We find these flaws and fix them before people attack our electrical grid. So there's probably a lot more, but that's kind of a little taste of Wednesday's Black Hat. We'll do this tomorrow. I think there's a lot of good things coming up tomorrow, including more car hacking with Charlie Miller and other stuff like that.
They're back.
And we'll try to do some at DEF CON, too, which I think we like even more than Black Hat.
Yep.
So that's it for today. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you for watching.